Thank you. It's really fantastic to be back here again next year, and I feel very honored. I feel a bit like the token hardware person that gets invited to Books and Browsers, and I've learned a lot yesterday and through the course of the years of Books and Browsers, and I guess I want to share on how I think what you're doing intersects with what's happening in hardware right now. We're at an inflection point in our industry, and I thought it's pretty relevant in what's happening in the device space, and I think relevant to this audience. So, and the reason that's relevant is, you know, the future of reading, it's very clear, it's obvious to you, has to do with screens. I've been working on making screens all of my adult life. Basically high-end screens, low-end screens, all different kinds of really innovative screens. And I believe the future of screens is intricately linked to reading and more. And a lot of the more part was shown yesterday in this, the what becomes of social reading and how that unfolds. And I think the people in this room have a lot to say with how that will unfold. And I want to inform you on what's going on in screens. So, the title of my talk was supposed to be an update on what's happening in readability and legibility in screens, but I really wanted to expand that a little bit and also talk to you about really what's happening in the hardware industry. As I mentioned, we're at an inflection point, and I'll explain why. And then also talk to you about the near future of what's happening in screen technology and device technology. So, let's start with the state of the hardware industry. If you care about screens, you have to think about, you know, what's going to be coming down the pike in terms of new screens. And to really look at that, you actually have to look at what screens you can make. These days, when you introduce a product, a new cell phone, you've got to ship 1 million units a month. A new device, a couple hundred thousand a month at least. That means you actually have to use manufacturing facilities that exist. Well, guess what? The only manufacturing facilities that exist that can move that kind of volume these days are LCD. That's the stuff that's in blue on the left side in the graph, and that's the world's manufacturing supply for screens. There's not really any differentiation before. 10 years ago, that graph looked very different, but today it looks like that. And that screen production is controlled by four countries, mostly Korea and Taiwan. Japan is sort of eclipsing, and China's really coming online. And the way that plays is fairly interesting. There's a capacity glut. There's a huge capacity glut. Huge. And that's because it's a little bit of geopolitical game. China is bringing on more and more capacity. They say they're going to bring on another 15% worldwide capacity this year, and that means the cost structure for LCD is extremely low. It's almost impossible for anything to beat it. So, you know, the question really is, how do we innovate with the existing manufacturing capacity? This manufacturing capacity, just to give you an idea of scale, it's $400 billion dollars worth of investment across 150 fabs. That's about double the solar panel investment. You've heard about China sort of creating a glut of capacity on solar and things being underwater. Well, you know, the display industry is pretty similar, but a lot bigger. It's been underwater for some time. There's not a single company making screens in the world today that manufactures the screens that's profitable. Let me say that again, because it's a really key point. There's not a single company in the world today that makes screens that's profitable. The screen is the most expensive and the most power-hungry component in any device. It's what we look at, it's what we read off of, and the people making them don't make a dime. They're losing money. They've been losing money for 5 years. So the industry is about to change. It can't continue much longer like this. And that's what I wanted to talk to you about today. I live and breathe and work in this industry. So meanwhile, in the device space, you guys know Apple's been doing pretty well, very well. Here's the state of affairs as far as profits in the device industry. Pretty much everybody but Samsung and Apple is a not-for-profit. They really are. Apple makes margin, Samsung makes margin. HP has a services industry that makes its money. Everybody else is pretty much break even. And that's because Apple and Samsung have invested heavily, billions of dollars, in generation N plus one components. The rest of these guys, relatively speaking, have invested zero. You'd like to think that Apple's doing so well because it's the store, because of the ghost of Steve Jobs, but part of it is the device is better because it's got better components in it. Same thing with Samsung. Apple actually doesn't make anything. Not a thing. Foxconn, a Taiwanese company, makes pretty much everything for Apple. Quantum makes some of the MacBooks, but pretty much Foxconn makes stuff. Samsung's vertically integrated and makes its components. A lot of its generation N plus one components are made for Apple products, and it's been well publicized that they're in some dispute. They're just fighting for first place, and everybody else is in a distant third. And what this spells for the future, if you don't want a system controlled sort of end-to-end, content, software, the store, by a single company, the delivery device, it is the device. They used to say that about, you know, cigarettes, the nicotine delivery device, right, is the cigarette, stop the cigarettes. Well, the information delivery device is the device, and if it's only Apple and Samsung, we're doomed to that world. We need more diversification in hardware. These guys maybe deserve what they got, and you know, basically Amazon, Intel, Microsoft, Google are jumping into the game because they're tired of Apple eating their breakfast, lunch, and dinner, right? So this is Microsoft's week. They're introducing, I think, finally for sale their tablet today. We'll see how it does. So there is some movement to try to create a different future. But right now, it's no surprise to you Apple's doing well. I see a lot of their products in the audience. But if you want to basically sell your content through the Apple Store, you know what's going to happen to you. So you're interested in diversification in hardware too. So a lot of people think that this is really the manufacturing's in China and China controls the industry. It's not true. 95% of all motherboards, 90% of all notebook PCs, 85% of all tablets are manufactured by Taiwanese companies. Taiwan is actually effectively a different country than China. It's a democracy. I live there. I live in Taipei. And it's separate from China. And I think that it's not really widely known how this all works. There's very little silicon left in Silicon Valley. It's moved. It's moved to Taipei. And if you want to have a voice in hardware or in this device space, it's necessary these days to spend most of your time in Taipei to have influence over that. So I've been doing that for a number of years. I've been shipping high volume devices, components, TVs, head mounted displays, and so forth for a long time. I started spending a lot of time in Taiwan in 1999 with my company that I co-founded called MicroDisplay. I was an executive at Intel and spent a lot of time there. Then I co-founded One Laptop, Her Child, and architected the $100 laptop to go to the developing world to give children without access to education some access, and got an apartment in Taiwan to be able to mass produce that, and then spun out of One Laptop, Her Child, and now founded and run a company called Pixel Chi, making innovative screens inside of this infrastructure. So that's why I'm talking to you about this today. And it's my considered opinion that, you know, the screen is really the central component in these devices. It used to be it mattered what the CPU was, right? But now the CPUs are it's hard to tell what's under the hood. What the most expensive, again, and by far the most power-hungry component is, and what a device really is these days, is the screen. And increasingly that's going to be the case, I'll argue, and show you why I'll argue that. But we have to care about the future of the display industry if we like reading, because we read off of these things. And there's two basic models: the glowing DRAM model, and DRAM is it's the stuff in flash memory. It's the stuff in a thumb drive. It's kind of indistinguished. And sort of imagine this glowing. That's your screen. Consolidation happens in this nonprofit industry, or not for profit. Massive loss industry. And, you know, there's Samsung gets, you know, some of the, there's three companies, two or three companies emerge. Samsung is one, Foxconn's another, and maybe China Inc. with a Taiwan sub or Taiwan Inc. with a China sub. And their innovation slows. There's still some innovation. And maybe in 10 years, some new display or new device technology comes along, because the incumbents have kept things going too slow for too long. The other sort of reality that we could unfold over the next couple of years is what I call the display ASICs. ASICs are basically a lot what, you know, Qualcomm, NVIDIA, Broadcom, all these companies that make chips. They design the chips here in Silicon Valley, or in the case of, you know, Qualcomm San Diego, and they send the files to a factory, and the chips are printed. And they create very distinguished different chips using the infrastructure of the fabs. That's what I'm doing at my little company with the incredible team that I put together, one of who is here in the audience. And we're making a go at that, and we've actually shipped millions of screens that way by designing them and giving the file to the fab, and then they print the screens for us. We use their manufacturing process as is, but what comes out doesn't at all look like an LCD. It's a really innovative screen. And I believe, you know, that has to happen to get us to ambiently powered devices, rollable, foldable, like, you know, sentient screens that are smart, thin, and so forth. So just to segue a little bit, I'm supposed to talk a little bit about readability and legibility today. And just an update from last year, where I spoke about it at length, and there was some hunger in the audience to talk about it today. And a lot of people ask me, because I make screens, what's the best screen for reading? And I think one of the speakers yesterday said, you know, the studies say there's no difference. Some of the studies say there's no difference between LCD, electrophoretic, that's e-ink, and paper. And some of the studies say that, and others say, you know, there is a difference. That reflective kind of anti-glare screening, reading on paper is the best, electrophoretic is second best, LCD is third best. And I believe the discrepancy really has to do with flaws in the study. I think there's multiple ways that we read. We do long-form reading where we read carefully, and we do scanning reading where we read quickly. And we the LCD that moves fast is better for fast reading. And so our take at Pixel Chi is, let's make a screen that does both, that allows us to do comfortable, anti-glare, you know, reflective, long-form reading, and has the video update and color and so forth to allow fast searching. And we've actually been doing that now for 8 years and have shipped millions of products that way. Sort of a little bit more detail on that. This is a nice study I like. The same audience was given a paper. You know, the average time that it took to read a 10-page academic paper on paper, sorry, it's called, use the word paper, an academic, you know, submission to a journal that's like 10 pages long, on paper, took 22 to 45 minutes. And when, you know, academics read it online, they could read it really fast, in 74 seconds. Computer science professors could read the fastest of everybody, 55 seconds for a 10-page academic document in a journal. This isn't real. It's not that they're reading on paper more slowly than an LCD. It's on LCD, they're scanning to see if they should bother to read it, right? And that's part of the flaw of the study. They're searching for information very quickly. And then if they really want to read the paper, they'll print it out and read it very slowly. And that's, I think, more what's going on here. And sort of to sort of describe that, if we study how our eyes scan a page, on paper, we generally read, well, in this one in German, left to right, other languages up, down, or right to left, or whatever. But, you know, in almost every word, the eye jumps over the page because that's how your eye moves, and it sort of, it's saccadic, and it which is very fast. It sort of focuses and catches the, and then moves along. You think it's actually scrolling along, but it's not. But on a screen, you know, if you want somebody to notice something, up and to the left, and around a picture. That's where people read the words to see if they're interested. And so it's just a very different type of reading. That's why a computer science professor can read an academic paper in 55 seconds. And they're not really reading it. They're deciding if it's important and if they should read it. And so how do we make a screen or a reading experience that's good for both? That's what we're trying to do. There's other issues for readability. There are people say, you know, backlights are bad, and some studies show backlights are okay. Well, there's a certain portion of the population that has extremely bad reaction to backlights. They get migraines, headaches, dizziness, and so forth. In fact, 25% of the population has some issue with light sensitivity, but a much smaller percentage, and that's under some dispute right now, has an issue with the backlight brightness. And so we actually, since we ship screens where you can turn off the backlight and still see the screen, get fan mail almost every day of the week from people who couldn't use a computer screen before to do search. They love e-ink. E-ink doesn't have a backlight. They love paper, but they wanted to be able to, you know, be on a web page and have a faster experience. And so we have users like that. It's a certain percentage. There's people in the audience today that have much more knowledge of the exact percentage and across the studies. But I've linked to some you know, websites that talk more about this. So there's that. So there's a small percentage of people that can't deal with backlights, but there's a lot of us, the vast majority of us, do experience ocular discomfort, eye strain, from time to time with our screens. And, you know, it used to be with older screens there were issues with contrast ratio, with resolution. That's been fixed. Now the dominant issue is really the lighting and glare of the environment and how that interacts with the screen. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about what I mean by that. Also, the issue is sort of looking at the screen, really, that's very bright with the lights all off behind it. That's also can cause eye strain. So, you know, I call that kind of tunnel vision. There's a woman reading her tablet in the dark. And that's, you know, a tunnel of brightness with a surround of darkness. And that causes eye strain. One of the best books on the legibility of print is called The Legibility of Print, which is out of print, by a guy named Miles Tinker, who spent his entire life studying this and published his life work in the early 60s. So it's about paper, but it's very, you know, cogent to what we're talking about here. And he called it actually hygienic vision that you should have, you know. When I was a kid, my mother told me, you know, not to sit too close to the TV. It would burn out my eyes because the room dark and turn on the lights. And, you know, old wives' tale or, you know, actually, well, you know, there's a lot of data to show that this brightness in the center surrounded by darkness causes eye strain for most people. The other issue is glare, where the light reflects off of the screen, and so you're looking at two images. You're looking at a mirror image of yourself and the screen. That causes eye strain. That's a huge problem with existing screens with backlights. So contrast and resolution used to be an issue, but that's, you know, gone away as the contrast and resolution have increased. A lot of us in the industry have bought high-resolution screens for years, but Apple is very good at communicating with its customers, and when Apple tells you resolution matters, people get the message and everybody follows. So thank you, Apple, for upping the resolution of your devices and explaining to people how important it is, particularly for text. So, glare. Here's an example of glare. This is with the room lights on on three different screens, a glare screen, a matte surface screen, so-called anti-glare, and our screen. The reason reflective screens are better is because room light adds to the screen experience, doesn't subtract from it. In the case of these two screens, the middle and the right screen, the room light takes away from that. If you turn off the lights in the room, you get that tunnel problem. So that's the issue now with screens. And so adding some reflective component to the screen so the room light doesn't subtract from the image is very important. So here's just a quick little video of some of the screens that we make. I have some here, actually. You know, here's screens that we make. They're thin, they're modern. You know, we're looking at a future where this little PCB is the motherboard. So this whole thing becomes the device. Right now, this is a motherboard running Android. It fits in a USB dongle, right? And you can plug it in. So these are screens, and I can show them to you live a little bit later. Yeah, it's sort of dying. Okay, so finally, before I stop talking about legibility, I'd like to make a plea. I made the same plea last year. In a printed page, about half of the page is used for margin and half for text, which is tough because, as I mentioned, the screen's the most power-hungry component in a device and the most expensive, so half the area isn't used. It's okay. An issue that we have in the books and browsers is the browser takes up way too much space and the book way too little. 14% of the screen area is used for the book, and it's really hard to read. And so I beg to you, if you only design for, say, Apple, maybe it's Amazon, whoever, if you only design for one company's products, you get the future you design for. It becomes a monoculture, and the restrictions that you're talking about in the publishing industry are kind of the same in the device industry. You have to be on that product. So I know it's hard to write software for multiple platforms or for even just for multiple screens, but here's my plea. Do it or you define your own future. So I've talked a bit about the screen power consumption and about Apple's sort of quadrupling the resolution of its screens. That's great. They did that, and it makes it much more readable. But the issue there is dead area. The transistor that is needed in each subpixel stays the same size, blocking most of the pixel. In the case of an iPad 3, less than a third of the light has an open aperture that can get from the backlight to the front of the screen. And so what Apple did was crank up the backlight. They cranked it up a lot. The iPad 3 is a little bit heavier, and you've probably seen the overheating reports. This is Apple's flagship product. It's a 9-watt machine, and 8 watts of that power budget is taken by the screen. That, just to give you an idea of scale, Intel will respin a chip to save 10 milliwatts. That screen takes 8 watts. Apple and everybody else has quadrupled the power consumption of screens in the last 4 years. We actually work on low power screens. But power really matters. Power really matters because you can have a zippier chipset. You can multitask. You can beam information to another machine. You can do a lot of things if you have more power. I co-founded an organization called One Laptop Per Child. These were our customers, the children in the developing world. They don't have power. The work that I've been doing spins out of that, of how do we make a self-powered device, a device that's so low power, a small solar panel or a small hand crank can repower it. I believe that's the future, not just for the poor people of the world, not to cross the digital divide. These people need access to information too. And if we make the power consumption go up but not down, we create a larger digital divide, effectively. So That's my plea. So the way we did that was actually by making part of our screen reflective and part of our screen transmissive. And we've actually been doing small aperture screens with high throughput for a long time, funneling the light through that small aperture by thinking about the optics of the system very carefully, and can get very high throughput even if the transistor stays the same size, even at the resolutions of these high resolution, Apple calls them retina, but whatever, to 300 pixel per inch screens, to lower the power consumption from 8 watts down to 1 watt. And so these types of screens that we're making we plan to put them into mass production next year. We're doing our final partner selection right now, and the world of the device makers has been beating a path to our door this year as we choose who to work with for these next generation screens. But I want to talk a little bit beyond that. When you have extra room for transistors in your pixel, you can put more functionality in there. You can put a camera in there, an integrated touchscreen in the backplane, and even play with the notion of a pixel. That we're updating each of these white dots at 60 frames per second with that projector is ridiculous. The screen should be able to self-wire itself and say, you know, that's a block of white, that's a single pixel, and it's not changing at all. What on earth are we doing updating the component in a device that takes 70 to 90% of the power at that kind of rate? It doesn't make any sense. And so what we can do with the extra space is wire in transistor set that allows us to take something that's in the JPEG format and bring it directly to the screen. It's information that's thrown away by something called the GPU and not transmitted to the screen because the screen is a raster, and we have to rethink the screen to be a smart screen. So, you know, really what we're looking at doing and in our industry is lowering the power consumption of devices over the next 5 years by 100x. That means our devices, our tablets, our laptops can be powered with a small solar cell just like today a calculator is. And that allows more devices, more screens, more usability. And so that's what I wanted to share with you today. So thank you for your time. I'm told I have 3 minutes for questions. I do. I have a whole bunch of screens that you can see outside. In fact, I have like this one. It's not on. You can throw it on the ground. You can stand on it. You know, this is a product being announced Monday, so I can't tell you the. But you know, we make screens that go into a lot of different products, dozens of products, and we have some other screens that are more in commercial products. These are for the construction workers of the world. But yes, I can at lunch particularly because you can see them outside. Oh, I'm told I can have one more question if there is one. Yes. There's a list of devices at pixelchi.com. There's dozens.